just 30, we realized that we needed some synergy. There had to be a starting point. And so, since there didn't appear to be one, we created it. And this is really the baseline for our report. I think many of you are only too well aware of what the position is. Climate change is a threat to our food system. If you look at what's happening right now on food insecurity, we are facing for the first time hunger in real numbers. The World Food Programme has spoken about the ring of fire, and many of our member states in the Commonwealth are within that ring of fire. As far as the Asian continent is concerned, it is 19% of the global food and agriculture exports. Africa, 17%. This sector employs 9% of the population in the Caribbean since, and the sector contributes about 14% of the GDP. So this work is of vital importance for us. I'm very glad that Ben is going to be on the panel, and I'm very conscious that there are going to be a plethora of experts who will be working together. So I just want, if I may, to say some very basic things in relation to what we now need to do. Data is vital. Understanding the data, being able to aggregate it, disaggregate it, to make it the baseline for our policy development. And our member states have to know their own data, own their own data. But also, we need to create data sets which are interoperable, so we can better understand what works, what does not work, and we'll be able to forge a better future for all of us. And so, this report was the Commonwealth's first attempt to try and create that baseline so that we all have a framework with which to work. And we've been talking about how to do it. And this report very much comes in the form of a building. It's very similar to a Greek temple. It has five components, has a roof, three pillars, and a base. And the roof really is the temple representing the key systemic issues that we need to deal together. I'm going to begin to entice you with what the roof covers. But the first pillar is the digital architectural innovations consisting of digital technologies and services for agriculture. The second pillar is the agriculture or data infrastructure. The third pillar is the business development services, and the last, the base of the temple, representing the enabling environment for digitalization of agriculture. We know that if we work together, we will be able to come up with solutions. I'm delighted that we are working together. I know that if we continue in this way, the Commonwealth being representative of five regions of the world, we've got every type of country, big ones, small ones, island states. If we can come up with something which will work, I believe it could be a pathway for the rest of the world. It's my great pleasure to formally launch this report for consideration. We thank you in advance for all the acuity, the judgment, the knowledge that you will bring to this consideration, because everything you do will be used and needed by the world. So on behalf of my 2.5 billion people, I say a very profound thank you. And I know that Ben will take you through the detail in a way that I think you'll find very helpful. And I think that's short enough, because you want me to go very quickly.
Thank you, Excellency, and you definitely welcome your presence here. To stay as long as you want as well. I would like to invite the Deputy Director Baker to just say a few brief remarks as well.
Thank you, Kurt, and thank you very much, Secretary General. It's an honor to have you again here in our pavilion. I hope the technology is working better today than it was a week ago. I understand there were some Effort is one of the whole panoply of tools that we have in order to make agriculture part of the solution. We're here today because some members of the Commonwealth and member states and ACA as well, important member countries, teamed up with all the rest of the Americas in order to put forward statements, a declaration of ministers of agriculture about what we feel is important for the crop and how we can help with digital solutions, genetic solutions, just common sense solutions in order to reduce the impact of agriculture on the environment while improving our productivity. So this book that you put together from the 2.5 billion members of the Commonwealth is going to be a great tool for us and a great asset for us. Data is pivotal in order to have science, in order to have that foundation of enabling policies, which we work on either. So again, we're very honored to have you, and thank you so much for launching this publication with us.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We'll allow the Honorable Mr. Stephen to leave, and then we will proceed with the panel discussion. Thank you. So, colleagues, we will continue with the technical issues on the subject, digital solutions and information for climate resilient agriculture. I think Adrian Kruckman has joined us. Welcome, Adrian.
Thanks for your welcome. Nice to be here.
I introduced you in your absence. Yes, so we will proceed directly to the question. I know we have a large panel, so we'll proceed directly to the questions. Ben, you have a very important publication. It is important, particularly when we're creating awareness, to begin to document successes, opportunities, and potential. I will start with you. Why are digital solutions important for building a climate resilient agriculture sector?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that question. And thanks to ICA for the opportunity to be part of the discussion. I was just telling Molly that I used to be an agricultural extension officer. But before that, I used to be a small media farmer with my parents. So I know what it takes for smallholder agriculture to take place. And with the climate variability, the traditional knowledge of our smallholder farmers is no more holding, it's no more, you know, functioning as it used to be. Farmers used to look at clouds and make decisions and know that it's going to rain tomorrow and they're going to sow their seeds. They know the direction of the wind and they know that there's going to be this kind of pest, you know, coming from east to west. That kind of knowledge, that's what, you know, we used to follow when I was a child following my parents. But as of today, some of those knowledge is no more working because of the climate change. So I'm not a technologist, but I've been studying some of these innovations over the years, and also with this report and some of the reports that we produce on this shows that digital solutions and technologies, I do refer to it as digital innovations that combine solutions and the technologies are enabling smallholder farmers to better take decisions on some of these issues. Across Africa, there are a lot of those innovations, some supporting insurance, So if the farmer suffers from drought as a result of, you know, this climate variability, they take decisions based on their knowledge, and you know, things change and it's not working, then they lose as a result of drought. And because of that, they need to be pushing. So there are index-based insurance that are supporting farmers through data and digital solutions to be able to cushion them against flood, pests, and drought. There are some of them that are helping them to increase productivity. Some of them are allowing them to capture data. Drones and satellites are helping. Farmers are not using it themselves. Smallholder farmers are not using it themselves, but enterprises and entrepreneurs are using those to capture data to provide services to farmers. And once they have access to those data, it supports, it complements their traditional decision making, helping them to be able to be more efficient in their decision making and production. So if you look across the whole value chain, there are a lot of digital solutions. This report has outlined some of them in the Pacific, in the Caribbean, in Asia, in Africa, also in Europe, that are enabling, you know, smallholder agriculture and allowing them to not completely, you know, swerve the climate change, but to be able to cope with it as they continue with their agriculture.
Thank you, Ben. Maury, I think I would like to continue with you then. Ben, and the comment that I begin to document experiences that could be useful. Where are we in the use of monitoring, reporting, verification, MRV systems and platforms for the agriculture sector in the Caribbean region?
Yeah, thank you, Chris. Thanks to ICA as well for hosting us on this panel, and especially thanks to the Honorable Patricia Scotland for opening remarks. I think, and just to give you some context for how I'm approaching this conversation today, in that the Greenhouse Gas Management Institute has been implementing the Caribbean Cooperative MRV Hub. So it's a cooperative that has 12 member countries in the region. And we're into our tool that's been really useful in catalyzing that peer learning. I mentioned that ORB had data collections of CLIP, and then what we're looking to do in the future is create a regional data set where member countries can pull their data, house and information, and archive it there at the MRB hub. And what that will allow is then countries are able to rely on regionally specific data instead of international data sets, which when you're thinking about designing mitigation assessment policies, you need actual data from the countries for it to matter, not only to the decision makers, but to the farmers. So I'll leave it there, but I'm happy to take specific questions on many tools. Thank you, Chris.
So definitely we have there's monitoring, there's verification, there's tools, there's documentation of experiences. Mariana, let me turn to you. How has digital technology allowed you farmers in South America to improve the decision making, to improve efficiency in their activities?
Sure. Well, I'm a farmer myself, and I understood the importance of having data to decide what to do in the field, not only relying on intuition, what neighbors are doing, especially in a cold and changing environment and climate. So our platform monitors crops via sensors, satellites, input data by the farmer, and comes back with insights of what they should do, like from when to sow, risk of frost, risk of fire, how much to irrigate, disease risk. So that allows farmers to respond, to adapt to climate change and what is going on in their own land, but also to mitigate. But since they have the information, they start jet spraying when it's necessary in the right moment to avoid losses, and therefore they end up using better their natural resources, less inputs, which later results also less energy and less greenhouse emissions. So we are calling it like as a climate smarter agriculture strategy, as everything is measured can be managed. So we help farmers to manage reserve and adapting and mitigating to climate change.
Thank you, Mariana. I will follow up with Adrian, Mr. Trotman. The issue for us is how does our technology benefit farmers? And you have Mariana speak to specific issues, how they are utilizing it to help improve their management. You form an important part of a very important institute in the Caribbean. What are some of these digital tools that you use for early warning? And most importantly, how are these tools accessible to farmers in the region, farmers and institutions in the region?
Thank you. Question. Well, as you said, I am representing the meteorology fraternity in the Caribbean. And when you think about meteorology, yes, you think first and foremost of early warning for decision making. And I like to say BSCIMH, along with our National Meteorological Services, place a lot of focus on climate variability and extremes and changing climate. And we provide much information along the National Meteorological Services on how variable is our climate, what would it be like over the next 3 to 6 months, or if we have the relevant information maybe a year ahead for that kind of midterm planning, would the next wet season be wetter than normal or drier than normal? Would it be warmer than normal? Also, if you consider hurricanes as a real concern to the agriculture community in the Caribbean, we also focus on how active or particular season may be. So we utilize data, in-situ data from the region, but we also support this with remotely sensed data from satellite and server. And we'll be able to monitor the climate in that regard, what has happened recent times, and we actually combine that by looking at, so based on your recent past, what is the next 3 months suggesting? And how will that interact with the agriculture community, whether it's crops, whether it's stocks, and so on? And support them in making decisions as to what do I do to reduce impact from negative climate, should their research have for gas, that is, over the next 3 months or over the next 6 months. So there are many tools that we have available, and they allow for the agriculturists, whether it be a farmer, whether it be an extension officer serving the farming community, that allows them to make certain adjustments to their activities. And one of the things we have been introducing in the Caribbean to allow that connection between meteorologists, extension services, and farmers is what we call the participatory integrated equipment services agriculture approach, which is done in Africa. And we've already introduced this approach where you're talking about making decisions based on context, based on understanding the climate, and understanding whether the near future climate, whether it be a week, a couple weeks, a month, 3 months, 6 months, whether that climate basically forces you or encourages you, should I say, to make a different decision than you normally make, because this upcoming season is not expected to be a normal. So we have a number of tools on our webpage looking at drought, dry spells, extreme excessive rainfall, whether it be warmer than normal. All these are decision support tools that exist on the webpage and the webpages of a member of the National Meteorological Services across the Caribbean. That's where I will stop for now.
Thank you very much, Adrian. Ben, welcome to you now. Essentially, we're saying we could consider what part of digital agriculture, using digital technologies to manage resilience, as an emerging sector of funds. In that regard, we also have the issue of the digital divide. So, what are the considerations for national policy design that we must take into account at this time, particularly where smallholder farmers are concerned? You heard Adrian speaking to access for the smallholder farmers. What are these considerations you should have in mind?
So if you have time to look into the report and some other reports that profile the solutions, you see that there are a lot of solutions out there in each country across the Commonwealth. You have lots of digital solutions that are supposed to be serving the smallholder farmers. So in 2018, 2019, we carried out a study in Africa on the state of digital agriculture in Africa. So we call it the digitalization of African agriculture. And across Africa, there were about 400 digital solutions operating in Africa. And these solutions have registered over 33 million smallholder farmers. But into the agriculture, into their systems. And the term they use is they are reaching the farmers. But the farmers who are actually using the service is one third of that. So there's a reason why that is happening. So the technology is good. They have developed the solutions, the apps, the content, and everything. They register profile farmers into their system. They will start, sending them messages on market, on extension, on finance. But farmers don't continuously use it. That's where the gap comes. So registering farmers is another thing. That's what the term they use, reach. But the actual users is another. That's the divide. And one of the reasons why we found was that it's the business model around it, around these platforms. So most of them are driven by donor funding. So 2-year, 3-year projects, farmers like it. After that, you ask the farmer to pay, but farmers are used to free extension services, so then they are not willing to pay to your drone. Tomorrow, new innovation comes, supported by another drone. And so you see they are investing in the solutions, but the divide is there to. So that we are not reaching those that we are expecting to reach. So the program I work on at the Secretariat is a trade program and has an agricultural component. So our goal is to create that enabling environment for our government to be able to help for the technologies to work, to bridge that divide, so that you invest in the technology, you also make sure that it gets to the users. And some of the policy issues that we are looking at in this report that we released, some of the policy issues that we are looking at, one of them is the fact that if you go to the countries, our member countries, they lack digital agricultural policies. They have agricultural policies, they have information technology policies, but they don't have integrated digital agriculture policies. So the enterprises that are operating in the country, they do their thing free, no regulation. So they are there for business. So they make their business, they are not concerned with the smallholder farmer. And as a result of that, they are doing their business, they are competing among themselves, and the divide is increasing. So that is one thing that we think our government needs to take action. You need to put in some policies and regulations that combine agriculture and technology together, so that if an enterprise comes to your country and they are interested in supporting access to finance through digitalization, they need to follow this to be able to serve the vulnerable communities. The other part is the data part, the data which we refer to it in this report as data infrastructure, from what Molly was saying. So there's so much data capturing taking place. So for example, in that report, not this one that we did for Africa, Kenya alone in Africa had over 100 platforms operating in one country. And all these platforms are capturing data into various data systems. They are registering the same farmer into their systems. Because if I don't register you, I'll not be able to deliver services to you. So you see the duplication of the data systems that do not talk to each other, as my Secretary General was saying. So with that, it's difficult to scale, because there's competition among the enterprises. So if you don't scale, you see the divide. The farmers will taste it, the pilot will like it, but they are not going to get a continuous service. So you continue to create the divide.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Ben. I think, Federico, I think it's very important that I bring you in here. How is ICA helping the countries with this issue of policy? Or what are the steps that we plan to take to assist countries with getting the kind of policy that we require to address some of the issues that they raise?
Yes. Well, thank you very much, Carl. Good afternoon, good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to be here sharing this important event with you. Of course, I agree completely with my colleagues said. First of all, I think that we agree that digital technologies are completely necessary to face the main challenges that the agricultural systems are facing today, and especially the mitigation and adaptation to climate change. Of course, as Benjamin was saying, anyone discuss the benefits that the digital technologies have to the agricultural systems. However, as Benjamin said, there are significant divides all over the work I will take in this center. So the challenge is to get benefits of digital technologies as soon as possible while we prevent from digital technologies becoming an exclusion factor. And to this end, policies to promote digitalization from the government, from the states, are completely necessary and crucial. As mentioned, we need national digital agricultural strategies and national agricultural data infrastructure as many things to promote this, this process. From MIGA, and this is finished, from MIGA we are fully committed with the objective or goal of promoting digital agriculture. To this end, we created the Hemispheric Program of Digitalization of Agri-Food Systems, and from that program, we are working with the country members to promote a dynamic and inclusive digitalization, the digitalization of agri-food systems.
Thank you very much, Federico, for that. Okay, the next question. Everyone is will be free to take a stab at it, but I'm hearing that Molly is working in MRV, Benanema documenting solutions, carrying a project, introducing digital solutions. You see Mariana using it in the field, CIMH is using it in the field. So we have several pieces, and then I think Ben also alluded to it, several different platforms competing. What is the coordinating mechanism for all these important pieces of the puzzle? To work as it should be. How do we coordinate to optimize service to the countries? And just off the top of your head, what are your views of them? How do we go about optimizing all these pieces we have around the place? What is the mechanism in your own view? Molly, I would like to start with you.
Yeah, I'll be brief. The information itself. So if I just challenge everyone that's working on the system development to ask the first question, interoperability on the upstream side of things and on the downstream side of things for any tool you're using. And there's the interoperability of the data itself, but then also the communication pieces that those components of the system produce. So they need to be producing communication pieces that are of interest and useful to the farmers, and they need to be comprising communication pieces that are interest and useful to the farmers.
Adrian, let me turn to you. What, I mean, your work is specific in curricular, in CARICOM, climatology, meteorology. What would you like to see in terms of coordinating for digital technologies in Caribbean?
When I think of my work in ontology, I use the word integrated, which I think is very important. And the words integrated and coordination have to be more or less linked. What we need, let me speak in the Caribbean, slowly, what we need in agriculture in the Caribbean is to recognize that there are many different players, many different actors who have their own roles. But we need to be able to bring all these players to one team. Let me give you an example. We recently conducted an exercise in a couple of Caribbean countries where we were talking about planning and decision making in agriculture when it comes to drought. And whereas we were all excited and already as meteorologists and climatologists in the Caribbean, one of the things we recognized is that over the years or over the decades, there had not been a lot of attention paid to collecting agricultural data. Sometimes the basic ones, simple yield, particularly of key crops in the Caribbean or in islands and nations in the Caribbean. So, because it's not the responsibility of the climatologist, somebody who's involved in climate decision making, to look after collecting new data, collecting commodity data, and so on. There's another player involved in that. So all the players have to come together and recognize they have a piece of the puzzle with respect to sustainability of our region's agriculture, with respect to resilience of our country's agriculture. The question is, who leads that process? Here we talk about the Nadika and the other regional entities in the Caribbean. But each one of the players, each one of the actors has a role that is important in building resilience in the agriculture sector. And let us join forces, however that may be, so that we build such a resilience that's important in the agriculture sector. Because we need to be able to a very large, much larger extent, be able to satisfy and support our own self-sufficiency in food production. And a large percentage of food in the Caribbean is included. And we need to be able to bring that number down. But we need to respond together and let each person, let each entity play its role. We are ready as climatologists in the region to play our role when it comes to providing the necessary information or decision making and responding to what could be unsatisfactory conditions in the future. And I'm not only talking about change in 2100 and so on, I'm talking about next week, I'm talking about next season, next year. And so we just all have to play our role together.
Thank you, again. Mariana. What would you like to see in terms of coordination to bring a better service for you as a farmer?
Sure. Well, I believe that we are talking about a complex problem that requires sustainable vision. So any player can't work alone. I believe this is like a platform economy challenge, where instead of like scattered directed solutions doing a small piece of a problem, we will see a consolidation into bigger platforms that can combine agronomic services, financial services, and ecosystem services. There is, of course, a need for regulation, for understanding and like standardization of the data for it to happen. There's been a mindset shift. So many players are still thinking like in silos, and I own my own data, I don't want to talk to anyone. And I think it will be like a transition to open economies where everyone has APIs that can transfer their data from one platform to another, because we do need all the data possible from all the different sources and different types in order to solve this challenge. And not only among tech players, but I'm also talking about government and NGOs and big corporations helping to create access. And there's different challenges to scaling up technology, infrastructure and connectivity. So that's something that we need to get improved in order to adopt more tech. Education, it starts from digital inclusion to understanding better agronomy and why caring for the environment is important, and it is powered like by nature to increase yield and ROI. As many farmers still think that being sustainable is against productivity. So we need like this mindset shift that we need orders like the ICA to work on education and financing. So I think I wasn't there yesterday. I just arrived back. I think the big thing for me from this year is financing. We need to finance the transition. And today there is no available resource for farmers and corporations to invest in adopting technology and adopting more sustainable practices.
Thank you very much, Mariana. Ben, as Commonwealth Secretary, what would you like to see at the level of the countries in terms of coordination?
Yeah, no, that's something that we have started talking about. So when I was talking about the data part, for example, weather data, in the Caribbean, in the Pacific, you may not see it now, but if you go to African countries, big ones like Nigeria, Kenya, Ghana, apart from the national weather stations, right, investment in lots of private weather stations. They are good because they are new technologies capturing data better than the national ones. But again, these are duplications. It's value in that. There's nothing wrong with duplication, building different. But so what the Commonwealth Secretariat is talking about is our governments need to coordinate it. They are not supposed to take control over it, but they need to bring the stakeholders together. And that's what we are referring to as agriculture, national agricultural data infrastructure. So the idea is that government put in, you know, the researchers who collect data from farmers all the time, and the NGOs that come to collect data, the digital solution, you know, the platforms that are collecting data every day, all of them to the same table and explain to them, look, you create, you know, the value you created is good. Data is fine, it's helping. But what you have in your data system, as a government, I don't know it. Your other enterprise doesn't know it. You know, World Bank comes to collect data. When they come, they don't know that you have that data. And they'll go and collect the same data. So our national government should bring all these stakeholders together and create a kind of national data infrastructure. It's not just technology, but that infrastructure is guided by policy, privacy, all kinds of things around it. So that the data that is already in the countries, they will be called to voluntarily contribute into this infrastructure. Voluntarily, not forced, because they are business data. So bring your data into this national infrastructure. Let's create added value. Because you are financial, somebody has weather, somebody has agronomy, somebody has soil. Let's bring them together. Now, let's form a multi-stakeholder trustee or custodian to manage it. Don't leave it to the government to manage. Don't leave it to the private sector alone to manage. Don't leave it to the farmers alone to manage. But let them all be represented and manage this infrastructure. So that tomorrow, when you come to my country and you are interested in cashew, and you want to invest in cashew, that is the first place you go in to look for cashew data. If you don't have enough, you are allowed to go to the food and collect data. But because you come in to get data from that national infrastructure, when you come back, you are required to come and put some data back into that infrastructure. So that next time somebody comes, you will not go and start from scratch. We'll start from there and build upon it. At the same time, the national government can use data in that infrastructure to make policy decisions. They will know, you know, how many cocoa, you know, farmers are across the country, how many cashew plants are, you know, you can have a good data within that. So the common law of our approach is that if you have that kind of systems in our member countries, then it's going to facilitate trade. You know, when there's so much to do somewhere in Jamaica, whilst you know, St. Lucia doesn't have, you can use this kind of data to make decisions. When India has a lot of machinery, they are looking for market, Kenya needs, you can easily communicate with these national systems to make decisions. So that is a practical thing that we are working on to see if it will work.
Okay, thank you, Ben. I don't think we should have a panel discussion without getting some input from our audience. I will open the floor to two questions, targeted questions. Is there anyone from the floor who has a question? Anyone in the audience? I don't see any hands up. Oh, just state your name, and if it's specific to someone, just state.
Thank you, Chairman Martin Ika. I just wanted to continue the conversation on you touched on the issue of privacy. And I wanted to, if the panelists could perhaps share within what is developing there, particularly within the Caribbean sector, how are you visioning the issue of the data ownership and the right to data and the conditions through which these persons gain access to data?
Such high hopes in digitalization of agriculture, and short, or you think that digitalization can't do it, we really need to work with another group to make sure that the digitalization piece, you know, it has to be inclusive. It's something that you think is missing in the area you're doing that digitalization won't work without.
Thank you. Panelists, we have two questions. I don't know which one you want to respond to. Ben, I think there was one specific to you.
Not specific to me, but yeah, the privacy issue is, so within our framework, we talk about user data and content data. So the privacy issue comes with the user data. The content data, you can use drones to capture soil, count the number of trees on the field, you know. Yeah, so that is content data. No big problem. But when you are capturing my data, my name, my location, the name of my village, the number of children I have, the situation I belong to, that's where privacy comes in. And I, for now, maybe Molly and others who are collecting can respond to that. But again, for us, if we work within this data infrastructure, then it needs to be protected, you know, and then decision can be made. But that's where maybe, you know, Molly can come in and share experience.
Yeah, there's multiple ways to handle it, right? And I'm going to answer both of your questions at the same time, because I think the thing that digital solutions won't necessarily always fix is building the trust between the users and the data. So that's where, going back to what you say, bringing people together in person to a common table will help you understand that. And I think in terms of privacy, just I'll give you an example. The work we were doing in the Caribbean where the port authorities are collecting data on a number of, say, chicken pens coming in that are going to be distributed for growing it on land. And we were communicating with the port authorities numerous times to try and get this data. They didn't want to give it to us because they were concerned about privacy issues. So then the question becomes, well, how do we get we sat at the table? They just didn't want the unique employee name attached to where that, they have this digital solution where they're just signing in. They didn't want to be attached to that data. We didn't necessarily need that information. So understanding the critical pieces of information that do need to be kept private for many reasons, not just privacy issues, but other reasons that, and then the data that can be made anonymous in a lot of ways that's still useful.
Thank you, Molly. Anyone else want to respond to the questions?
Go ahead,
Marianne.
And I'm not specifically to the Caribbean, but we follow like GDPR rules. So farmers have clear rules, they sign up to platform, how their data is going to be treated. We do use anonymized data to continue to build algorithms and models, but we won't disclose who they are unless they approve it. Like we have this mechanism where they can give access to an agronomist, to a corporation, to their data, and usually it comes with something in exchange. So for example, if you want a lower interest rate in the bank, then you can opt for sharing your historic agronomic data because you get a discount. Or sometimes in food corporations where they are supplier needing traceability to understand carbon footprint and so on, they usually receive a premium on adopting best practices and they are enrolled within a program at a corporation. So it's usually a concern, but when we talk about like how the data will become a benefit, both for him to adapt and improve his own returns, but also to obtain discounts and better conditions on services, that's usually not an issue as long as it is documented and have this permission framework.
Thank you very much. Adrian, wanted to add something?
Yeah, I want to go back to previous response. We talked about this thing, what is necessary for the digital world, information from that world to become more important, what would be missing. And I want to come back to the trust issue that was raised. I think that is key. I don't know how it is in other parts of the world, but traditionally, people hear if a neurologist or dermatologist issues some information, that the thinking is that you can ignore most of the time. You know, because there's a trust or a lack of understanding issue when it comes to climate information and how we respond to it. But driven by what is the global framework for climate services that's led by the World Meteorological Organization, one of the key pillars to being able to provide decision support to any community, not just agriculture, because we respond to a number of social sectors, agriculture is one of them. What is key is for the agriculturists, both the extension officer, the researcher in the agricultural field, the farmer, is to interface with neurologists and climatologists, to build that trust, and that's the word I want to reuse, to build that trust, but also to understand each other. You know, we all have limitations. We all can provide certain things that are necessary and certain things we cannot, especially as we continue to understand the systems that we respond to. So it is important that in using information from anyone is that you build that level of trust, engagement, interaction, so we know exactly the limitations of the others, what their strengths are, and how we respond based on the information as well. Particularly if, as in climate work, it's probabilistic. So building that, we need to do that. And we also have to build that trust across institutions and agencies, whether it be regional, like AICA, CIMH, or whatever the case may be. But that level of trust and understanding also has to come out. Thank you.
Thank you, Adrian. My colleagues, the hour is almost gone, just like that. When the discourse is exciting, this is what happens. Before I ask for a 1 minute closing statement from each of you, Federico, I'd like to turn to you. ICA is responsible for agricultural development, the technical cooperation mandate of the OAS. When we look at digital agriculture, what is the way forward? What are the next steps? What is it we're looking forward to in terms of the member states and other Commonwealth countries? What we should be looking for going forward in terms of achieving that development that we aspire for?
Yes, thank you, Kurt. Yeah, well, basically the digitalization of agriculture systems from our point of view is in the early beginning. So we have a lot of things to do from here to the future. So this is the best moment in which we can do things to promote digitalization of agriculture systems. And that is what IGA, in collaboration with other organizations, Commonwealth, are doing right now. So one of the things that we are trying to do is to identify and detect digital solutions and digitalization experiences, just to spread and communicate those experiences and solutions available and to learn from those experiences and to promote the quick adoptions of the thousand of available solution, as Benjamin said. And that is one of the things. The other thing, I would say two more things. That's one. The second one, as a lot of the panelists said, is the building of capacities. One of the main barriers for a dynamic digitalization of agriculture and production, agriculture and agri-food systems, is the lack of skills in most of the rural people and farmers. And what I think that we are trying to do is to work with other organizations and offer capacity building opportunities in order to provide those capacities required to adopt and use and take advantage of the digital solutions. And last but not least is the design of policies aimed to promote the digitalization of agriculture. And that is what we are doing with IGA also. trying to work with the countries, identify what they are doing, what policies are they implementing, how they are working, and to help them to design a new generation of policies aimed to promote the digitalization of agriculture with the goal of make that process very dynamic to take very early the great advantages that the digital technologies have, but at the same time that process to be inclusive. And that is basically what we are doing.
Thank you very much, Federico. Apologies for that. I will ask each panelist, I'll give you a 1 minute closing statement. Then I will start with you.
We just need to work together. Yeah.
Okay, I think someone has to use your time there.
Cooperation, and what that means is showing up to every conversation you can with something to give, something to offer before you ask.
Thank you, Molly. Mariana?
We can't achieve the 2030 agenda net zero without digital transformation.
Thank you, Adrian.
Digital transformation is key. It's very important, but we also have to remember that when you deal with the farm level, you're dealing with human interaction. And we have to consider both digital transformation and engagement at human level to put with respect to farmers.
Thank you, Adrian. Federico, and close, last minute.
No, I didn't say it before, but I'm talking to Ned from Argentina. I'm a farmer of myself here. I grow soybean, corn, maize. We are undergoing one of the worst droughts in Argentina. I lost all my wheat, all my barley because of the drought. And I know very well what the farmers feel when the climate change and variability is impacting the crops. I know very well that digital technologies can help us, the farmers, in this case, to mitigate and adapt to climate change and variability. So what we have to do is to cooperate in order to take advantages of all the technologies that are already available. And I think without allowing that the digitalization become an exclusion factor of process. That's all.
Thank you, Federico. And on behalf of the ICA and the Commonwealth Secretariat, we thank you for joining us today, and we thank the wonderful panelists that we had today. Very well, very good panel discussion. Very exciting, very interesting. Thank you very much. Round of applause, please. Bye. Thank you.